Awake, awake, O sleeper. Awake, awake, O sleeper.
Wakey, wakey, O sleeper. Hello, my friend. Glad to see you this morning or today. You know, don't ever underestimate the power of authority. Authority. Today I'm giving you a choice, my friend. You can either choose to be healed, choose to be heard, choose to be accepted, choose to be appreciated, choose to believe you matter. And I'll give you all that choice today. Or you can choose the opposite. You can choose to believe you don't matter, you're never heard, you're never appreciated, and you're never going to be healed. You could believe that, but I'm going to give you that choice today, and then the responsibility of how that turns out, whether in positivity or negativity, is going to rest on your shoulders. And I have good news for you. I want to heal you. The Lord wants to heal you. Jesus, by no means, has forgotten you. So we're going to talk about that. There is a man, and his name was Naaman. And he once was very sick. He had leprosy. His sickness could be seen by everybody, and I know not everybody has that same sickness. Sometimes our sickness is inside of us, and it cannot be seen by everybody, where others are physically wounded, some emotionally wounded. Now, Naaman had leprosy, and he was a good guy. Wasn't a follower of God or the teachings and instructions of God, but somebody who knew Elijah said, you know, I know this man back in Israel. I heard there's a God in Israel, and this, through this man, great things are happening. Go and find out. And all of his friends began to gather around him saying, boy, that's a good idea. Let's go and visit this holy man whom is doing great things. Perhaps he can heal you from your leprosy. So he sends a letter to the king of Israel. King of Israel reads his letter as the leper is saying, I heard there's a God in Israel, and I'm seeking to be healed. The king, in rage and in anger, tears his clothes and says, what, am I God? Who is these to think I am God? And Elijah hears what the king had did. He says, have the man come. Right? And Naaman gets word back. And says, all right, let's go. Him and all of his friends and his family are heading out. And there they come to Elijah's house. And Elijah doesn't even get up, doesn't even go to the door, doesn't even greet the man, but only sends word through a messenger to the layman and says, surely the Lord will heal you. Go to the Jordan River and wash yourself 7 times, and you will be cleansed and fully restored. Naaman became upset. Who is this man who calls himself a prophet? He was supposed to come out here and greet me, waving his arms across the air, saying, oh, in the name of God Almighty, by the power of my desire, come and heal this man. And he didn't even do that. He'd come waving his arms and saying some mighty prayer or anything like that. Instead, he tells me to go to the Jordan River. Isn't there any rivers in all of Damascus far cleaner than these muddy waters? Ain't a clean water in Israel. All of his friends begin to say to him, Father, you came here expecting something. You came here expecting to receive something. You came here expecting to be healed. And you expected that man, that prophet, to heal you. And now you're angry and you're going to go back and without washing 7 times in the Jordan River? You're not going to follow his instructions? You're only going to go away angry? Well, if you go away angry and you go home and you're not healed, you're always going to live with that thought. What if I had followed his instructions? Because he said it, the instructions were, you will be healed when you wash 7 times. It comes down to this. Authority. Authority. Do I believe in authority? The man said, you would be healed. All you have to do is follow his instructions. Believe in his authority. Finally, Naaman says, well, I suppose if I follow his instructions and then I'm mad, I could be mad at him and instead of being mad at myself. Am I worthy of the authority? Okay, let's go. Naaman washes himself 1 time in the Jordan River, comes out, and all the people, no, Naaman, you haven't been healed yet. Naaman washes himself a second, a third, a fourth, a fifth time, coming out of the water every time. And everybody looking upon him saying, no. Not clean yet. But on the 7th time, when he rose out of the water, he had the skin of a little child, and he was fully restored. And they all went away praising God. Now, my friend, don't worry, I have a story. I have another story. Good tidings, right? Right? Good tidings. Centurion soldier reporting for duty. Right? Centurion soldier reporting for duty. There was this centurion soldier who knew and understood everything about authority and how authority comes from discipline. Our reverence for authority comes from discipline. This man, that's all he knew. And there was a man who came into his town and became his servant, and that man knew God, and in fact, built a synagogue in his hometown, and everybody there began to worship God. And he heard Jesus of Nazareth was doing mighty things throughout the land, healing people, and had great power and authority. He, being a man of authority, knew authority, and yet also was humble enough to subject or submit to another authority, a greater authority than himself. His servant becomes sick. He searches Jesus out, comes to Jesus and says, "My servant back at home is sick and he's dying. He's dying. I know you can heal him." Jesus says, "I will come. I will go with you and I will heal him." The centurion soldier says, "Well, I can see greatness in you and the power of authority. I'm not worthy for you to even come into my house, but I do know authority and I do know the power behind your authority. When I say to my servants, come, they come. When I say, go do this, they go and they do that. And they understand authority. If you just say the word, my servant will be healed." Jesus looks at all of his disciples and his friends and says, "Wow, this man has more faith than anyone I have met in all of Israel. Subjects of this kingdom will be thrown out where there is weeping, gnashing of the teeth." But then Jesus looks at the centurion soldier and says, "Go, and it will be done to you exactly as you believed it would be done." And at that very minute, his servant was healed. Amazing. Don't ever underestimate, one, the power of prayer. Sometimes you ask for something, and yet do you believe you received it? And what's gonna convict you in believing you received it? And what if it was the authority you were given authority to receive, the authority to make a right choice? Sometimes we could ask for people for prayers, but if they don't pray for us, over us, right there, waving their arms in the air, does that mean you didn't receive your request? What if, through assumption, we expected the worst, and thereby we received exactly what we expected? We received to the measure of our own faith. I didn't believe my friend would pray for me or care for me. He has abandoned me. I asked my friend to pray for me, and I didn't see him waving his arms and making a fuss and calling down the fire of God for me. Now I'm upset and I'm angry, ready to weep, ready to cry. I know. I will publicly shame this so-called prophet. See, when we come to the altar of God in unbelief, God knows. God knows you don't believe. The evidence of the not belief is the willingness to crucify Jesus, bring Jesus to a place of public shame. Yet, where does that weeping, that anger, that frustration come from? God's love. God loves and punishes those who don't believe and who aren't convicted. God will deal with you in judgment, face to face. And what's the judgment? What's the judgment coming to the world? You are God's children. Being convicted of that being truth. It's holy and righteous. Being convicted. That's the truth. Seeing God face to face, and the judgment is, I am your father. Being convicted, I believe you. I believe you. We're always going to be failed. Find failure, disappointment, and frustration. That place of weeping and gnashing of the teeth. When I seek help from someone else. When I seek appreciation or acceptance or validation outside of the living God, outside of Jesus Christ. It's not my prayer God wants to hear in your behalf. It is your prayer God wants to hear. And God wants you to know, and you to realize, and you to understand, you matter. I'll give you three little sentences, words, statement, that if you believe them, then all of a sudden, God is. And when He is, all things are possible. You matter. I matter. I will, because He said, I shall. No. The reality. Okay, you're suffering from depression. Self-loathing or worthlessness. I need acceptance. I need validation. I need you to validate me. I need you to accept me. I need you to pray over me. Yet, how much, what about God? What about God? And God saying, I do accept you. I do hear you. I can heal you. What about God? I mean, if just think of how happy you would be if David could accept you, would pray for you, would listen to you. But God? God? Listen to me. Accept me. Why not God? Why not Jesus? This is my teachings. This is my instructions. I can only enjoy the personal relationship I have with Jesus, that I have with God. And I'm telling you, you can enjoy that same relationship. Personal, one-on-one, in secret places. God rewards those who do things in secret. Because it's the things done in secret. That's where God lives. How much greater is God's love than the love of a failing, weak man? And me, if I know the power of God and the authority of God, that God could go into a place I can't go. The power of his word can go to a place I can't go. To the depths of your heart, to the sinew of your bone, cut you right down. Yet we don't need a mediator between us and God. That's the glory of Jesus. That's the glory of Jesus. You can have that relationship. I'll tell you how to be healed. And I'll tell you right here today that you'll either be healed or you won't be healed because of the choice you made. Because you either assumed the worst or you expected the best. The best. And to your measure, to what you believe, it'll be done to you. I promise. Don't go to the pub. Don't drink any alcohol. Get rid of it. Get your butt outside. Go out into the country for a full day. Get out of the house and get some sunshine. Fresh air. Not saying going for a walk in the city. Get out where there's country. There's animal life. Nature. The wind can blow through your hair. And take 3 drops of CBD oil every night before bed. Your anxiety will disappear. Stop taking manufactured drugs, antidepressants, or anything like that. Get off of it. CBD oil will take away your anxiety, your fear to be around other people. I promise. I'm giving you the instructions. Are you willing to follow them? Do you want to be healed? Or do you enjoy going around telling everybody how sick you are? How hopeless you are? Don't come to God in vain and grieve God or the people of God because the choices you made or the choices of anyone else. It's not my obligation to carry that burden. I come here today because in a way I feel like I'm responsible for your salvation. Responsible, going to be held accountable. Even though I probably won't be. You're accountable for your own actions. Same way I'm accountable for mine own. But I know the love of God is for all people. It's available, it's ready. I know Jesus wants to heal everyone. I know that the desire of God is to put an end to our sorrow, and this is why Jesus came into the world, to take away the pain, to take away the sorrow. Scripture says, one more time, the earth will be shaken and the heavens will be shaken. But in the end, all things will be made new. Meaning God's going to take away everything that can be shaken. Take it away, throw it away. Every lie, every deception. What prevents us from being in God's presence? Sin. What is sin? I don't believe God. I am your father. Why are you experiencing punishment? Evidence. Evidence. Children. Do I not discipline children? Even us as human beings discipline our own children when they're doing wrong. Evidence. The suffering. Evidence. We are children of God. being upset and angry, not believing that you have received from your request evidence, always expecting the worst. It's in your own mind. Our battle, the war, the devil doesn't want you to believe you're God's child. The devil doesn't want you to believe God desires no sacrifice nor burnt offering. What's a burnt offering? What's that sacrifice? I'm willing to sacrifice a friendship because he wouldn't pray for me. Yet God says, I'm going to punish you because you wouldn't acknowledge my presence in your life. Thereby weeping, angry, burnt offering, a waste of friendship for the sake of my own pride. I'm willing to humble myself for the authority which comes from above. Authority God gives you. Here's the authority. You matter. Believe it. That's the authority. I will receive. I will be healed. That's the authority given to God, by God to you. I shall. That's the authority given by God to you. God said, I shall be your healer. He didn't say, David shall be your healer. He didn't say that guy or that guy. He said, I shall be your healer. Sin, not believing it. God desires to take away the sin. I guess there's no way we could sin when we're face to face with God. What was the judgment? Jesus said, didn't believe. Light came into the world, and it didn't believe. It said the truth came into the world, and yet the world didn't believe the truth. God said, I provided the way. And yet the world didn't believe in the way. But to all those who did believe, they received an eternal reward. God, a dad, a father, a healer, a provider. Recognizing that God wants to remove the pain. It must be painful, terribly painful, to not believe God is greater than David. It must be terribly painful to believe you can find acceptance and worth without the acceptance and value God has given you. God so loved us, he purchased us through his own precious blood, destroying the gap which separates us. Sin. My son. My goal is for you to believe and say, the Lord is my helper. Which man should I fear? O sleeper, the Lord is my shepherd. Which man should I fear? This is the desire of God. Is it your desire to be a part of the fulfillment of that word? See, none of our salvation can be complete until the Lord is your shepherd. but the Lord. And we will know and rejoice with you, because our salvation will be complete when you no longer feel rejected, when you no longer expect the worst, because there can't be worse if God is your reward. Shouldn't be angry or upset that God is your reward. What's the reward of being rejected by everybody? God. For he says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. I shall never reject you. He's only waiting for you to believe him. Waiting for you to believe him. Keep in mind, visit the country. Get some fresh air. CBD oil, 3 drops, 3 droplets every night right before bed. Within 7 days, your anxiety and your depression will disappear. Believe God, believe in his instructions. Don't be angry with me if you come here expecting something and yet are unwilling to receive that which what you were expecting to receive, because you assumed the worst. God has no desire to deliver to you the worst, but only to heal you, transform you, build you up, restore you, and to deliver you from out of the hand of the evil one, who says to you day and night, don't believe God, you worthless turd. Don't believe him. Stop listening to the devil. Start praying to God, believing he is pleased with the relationship you're about to create with him. With him. With him. With him. I love you. I love you all, especially love Ketu Denji. You know, I want to tell you a little story about purity of heart. It's a fearful and trembling thing to be in the hand of God. And why does God reward some while God doesn't reward others, and yet it all comes through our own faith and the measure of our belief. And I know who expected to find something, to know something. She knew that somewhere out there was a will greater than hers, and that will, whatever it may have been, was drawing her. And it was calling her, pulling her in. And she knew, man, if I surrendered to that draw, that will, this unseen force, I'm going to be transformed, and I don't know what that may entail, and I'm a little afraid, and yet the power of it keeps pulling me and drawing me, and I don't want to go, because in that I don't know what to expect, and I'm fearful. I have so much reverence for it all, and the transformation of it, and the excitement, and the unknown. I don't even know what's drawn me, but something's drawn me. Yet there's something in me saying, whatever you do, don't move forward. Stay right here. Come on, don't do it. I gotta see what this is. I gotta feel it. Something's calling me. Something's drawing me. And you got this little voice saying, don't do it. Stay here. You're safe here. Don't worry. And that little friend, that young lady, took her first step ever inside of a church. Tears, fear, and trembling, and emotions, and everything flowing. But when she steps inside, I find peace. And whatever was drawing me had no longer drawn, was pulling. Rather, it was holding me. It's wrapping around her, engulfed in it. Now in his hands. In his hands. I could imagine she probably felt like she floated right through the room, right to the front, next to the altar, and through the glory of being in the hands of the Almighty God. She fainted. Fainted. And it was like she had our body experience. Floated to places I couldn't normally go. And how was it able to go to places not able to physically go? I'm in the hand of God. Under the authority of God. Safe. Without worry or need. And I can ask my Father. And I could believe and trust in the power that can go anywhere it desires. Without limitation. And that God has a desire for you. For you. And the day that becomes a reality, I don't think it's a day of weeping, mourning, and gnashing of the teeth. How could it be? So we have hope for things to come. That's faith. Evidence. Evidence of it not being a reality yet. But we hope in it. We hope in it. This is why we all experience death. One death, once and for all. And in that, everything that is shaken and taking us away from believing in the truth, God is our Father, will be taken away. And there'll be nothing left to convict us of the truth. Then God himself staring at us face to face. Believe that. Believe you matter. Believe you're heard. Believe the healing is available to you, for you. All you gotta do is receive it. I matter, I will. Because he said, I shall. That's the Bible. Let's pray. Send in prayer. I love you. Heavenly Father, our Father, who lives in heaven, who lives within the heavenly realms, who opens our heart and our mind so that he may dwell within our kingdom, our vessel, our body, which is his temple. Unto you, Father, we submit our authority to your authority as we accept your word, as we are willing to receive our daily bread today, as you provide it each and every day. Open to us our mind and our body, to be able to walk into your courts confidently, seeking your forgiveness as we have tried to find help, recognition, and acceptance from places outside of you, leaving us crippled on our knees, weak, and in despair. Refreshing us. Restore our bodies, restore our minds. Father, give us the strength and the power to forgive those who persecute us, who don't make us feel as important as we should feel. Direct our steps. Deliver us from darkness. Deliver us from temptation. The temptation not to believe you. The temptation not to receive you. The temptation not to reverence you. The temptation to reject your authority. Lead us away from those things, so we may humbly submit ourselves to you as you deliver us from the hand of the evil one. For your kingdom is the power, is the glory, which we are all seeking here today. Fill us full of your wonder-working power, which comes to the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. 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 See you next time.
I cried a tear. You wiped it dry. I was confused. You cleared my mind. I sold my soul. You bought it back for me and held me up and gave me dignity. Somehow you needed me. You gave me strength. Stand alone again to face the world out on my own again. You put me high upon a pedestal. I finally found someone.